of the restricted base theory of QCD in one space, one time dimensions. And 1 year ago, at the rally conference organized by Joe and his friends, I presented the first part of this talk, which was mainly on the equal time formulation or the instant form quantization of the theory. And at that time, I had promised that by the time of the Frascati conference, we would present the full lifelong quantization of this theory. So, all the promises are not meant to be broken, and I keep my promise, and I talk about the lifelong quantization of this theory today. And the most part of this work has been done at the Iowa State University, and it's a part of our ongoing Delhi-Iowa collaboration. My both the collaborators happen to present here, James and Usha, who are just sitting here in the audience. And now, I would first like to explain the main idea behind this one. You see, in our QCD theory, it's a non-emitting theory, and you have chromoelectric gluons and you have chromomagnetic monopoles, and you like to study the interaction and the dynamics related to both of them. So, Professor Bai and Cho, I have never met him, but must be a very, very senior person, I suppose, and his collaborators, they gave this kind of a mechanism, which is in the literature called as the Cho decomposition, or more precisely, Cho Fadiev Niemi decomposition. And what you do in this decomposition is you decompose the non-Abelian potential A mu into two parts. One is called as the restricted potential, and the other one is called as the valence potential, which is the covariant vector field. And the other key point in the whole work is that, I mean, we know that the non-Abelian theories have rich topological structure and the associated dynamics related to this non-topological structure of the theory. So we introduce a topological field denoted in our work by n cap or n hat. So this topological field n is a O n vector and O2 scalar. So with respect to the two-dimensional Minkowski space, it's a scalar, but it has n components, the 1, 2, 3 up to, I mean, you can denote little n a, where this a is the QCD color index, so it has n components, 1, 2 up to capital N. And so what actually this field does is, it maps on the two-dimensional space onto the n-dimensional internal submanifold. So this is the main premises. And what happens as a result of this, the features of topological structures of the theory, they are revealed to a better extent. And by no means this particular choice that I am going to present is originally due to Professor Bai and Cho, but this is not by any means a unique decomposition. You can have infinitely large number of the choices. For example, for a given K mu, I can choose infinitely large, I can choose the unit vector n in infinitely large number of ways, or other way around, for a given little n, the unit topological field of unit norm, infinitely many choices for the gauge field A mu, which are gauge equivalent to each other. So I would go step by step, and I would first quickly review the basics of the theory. And the first part of this work was presented at the 94 meeting in Raleigh, and it is on the way of its publication. Professor Chung knows it better. And so the understanding of QCD and the confinement mechanism is surely very important, and one hopes that the confinement could be explained by condensation of the non-abelian monopoles. The dual dynamics of this restricted gauge theory of QCD, restricted by the abelian projection of the QCD potential, and this plays an important role in the confinement of the color. This RQCD theory describes the interaction between the chromoelectric gluon and the chromomagnetic monopole. I will illustrate its corresponding mathematics in a few minutes. And as I said, that this for short is also referred to the Cho decomposition, or as the Cho Fadier nearly decomposition. Here, this field A mu, the non-abelian potential denoted by vector A mu, is split or decomposed into one part. One is, I am denoted by A mu cap, which is the restricted potential, and the balance part x of mu. And we look at the we try to bring out the topological features of this theory. And as I said, this the two parts, this is a mu cap and this is capital of x mu, the balance potential. And the theory has full LC2 gauge degrees of freedom, as we will see it more explicitly. And this restricted potential a mu cap is introduced in such a manner that it allows one to introduce a covariantly constant unit vector n, so that its covariant derivative, capital D mu of n, would vanish. That is the idea, and everywhere there is this time which enables one to define the gauge independent color direction everywhere in space time. That is the main point. So, and I might go to the, yes, so you see the QCD theory is already a constraint theory, okay? I mean, it is defined in terms of the over-determined set of coordinates, and one can analyze the constraint dynamics of the theory using the most celebrated Dirac's procedure. However, if you introduce one extra field into the theory, and this field, this little n gap, the topological field, is constrained to have unit norm so that magnitude n square is 1. And therefore, you have some extra constraints into the theory, and the theory becomes even more severely constrained, as we will see in a short while. And then, here, the decomposition is gauge independent, and for a given A mu, one can have infinitely many different decompositions with different choices for this restricted potential A mu cap and x mu by choosing different topological field little n. Or equivalently, for a given little n, one can have infinitely many different A mu which are equivalent to each other. Now, so let us look at this expression A mu. This is the non-abelian potential, and I split it into two parts. This capital X mu is the vector, covariant vector, and is the valence part of this potential A mu. And these two first two terms are clubbed together. This is A mu cap. So this A mu cap is the restricted potential, and one has introduced this topological field n of unit norm, so n square is 1, and we will check that this A mu, if you take the dot product of this expression with little n, these terms would vanish because it would be n dot n cross d mu n. It's a scalar paper product, you can interchange dot n cross, and this term would go to 0, so only this term would remain, and this n, unit vector n, is perpendicular to x mu, so this term would also vanish, and therefore I would have a mu equal to n dot a mu. And one can also see that the covariant derivative of this little n vanishes identically, so that it's a covariant constant. Now, let us have a small check. So, you take this expression that I just showed on the last slide. A mu is a mu n minus 1 by g n cross d mu n plus x mu. So, this something which I have in the square brackets is a mu k. This is the restricted potential. And n square magnitude is 1, and n is perpendicular to x mu. So if I check it back, n dot a mu, I find that this term drops out, and this you can see. So this is n square is 1 is a mu, and this is a scalar product of n cross a mu n. You can interchange this dot and cross, and this guy will go to 0. So everything seems to be consistent. Now, after we check that, one can go into the Gibbs transformations, and it's very easy to verify that the theory would be invariant under these local vector Gibbs transformations. And now, so let us look at this this field strength F nu k also as a dual structure. So the one term, this corresponds to the chromoelectric gluons, and this other term corresponds to the chromomagnetic monopoles. This actually corresponds to that, and so this is your usual field strength F mu nu, and this is the field strength H mu nu. Here, A mu is the electric potential, and C mu tilde is the magnetic potential, and it would obviously satisfy the corresponding Maxwell's equations. So this d mu f mu nu tilde, this corresponds to the chromomagnetic monopoles, and so you have these identities corresponding to the corresponding Maxwell's equations, and then this it, so the whole process has allowed one to identify this non-immediate monopole potential, which is c mu, and you can re-express this h mu in terms of this. Now, with the above connection, R is one going to have, this is f mu nu is the same thing that I showed on the last slide, and I have substituted all those values there, and so eventually I can write down the Young-Mills Lagrangian density of the theory with all these terms. Okay, this we need to remember that this is a coupled term representing the chromoelectric gluons as well as the chromomagnetic monopoles, both this term, and this is corresponding to valence quark, valence potential. Now, as I said at the beginning, that this is by any chance, this is not a unique choice, and among the various choices that are available, so it represents a class of models. And among the various choices, I would first like to make the simplest choice. I would take capital X mu equal to 0. So my life is much simpler, and the theory, as you will see, if I put X mu equal to 0, this term will drop out, this term will drop out, this term will drop out, and this term will drop out. Only this term would remain, and this term would remain. So let us have a look into this very simple looking Lagrangian density now, where all these terms are precisely explained. And right now this lambda is a Lagrangian multiplier field, but we treat it as a dynamical field. We treat this lambda as a dynamical field, and so we associate also some dynamical movement corresponding to this lambda, and then everything is transparent. Now I put these things back into the theory. So this is my F mu nu cap, has that W plus HVU and W plus HVU and so on. And by simple multiplication, I would have these things. So this corresponds to the chromo electric gluons, and this corresponds to the chromo magnetic monopoles, and this is the coupled terms, and this term corresponds to the newly introduced topological field N. And now, so much so far, this is essentially trying to recap the basics of the theory. And now, at the rally conference, we have considered the instant form or equal time quantization of this theory. So I will go a little bit fast, my friends, then there's only 5 minutes left. So as I have said already, that this vector n is a O(n) vector and go to scalar. One can go into the, one can look at the canonical momenta, corresponding momenta, and one finds that the theory has three constraints, and these constraints, and this is the canonical Hamiltonian density of the theory, and this is the total Hamiltonian density of the theory, where I have incorporated the three constraints with the help of the Lagrange multiplier fields. Then I find two secondary Gauss law constraints. This eventually corresponds to this, reconfirms that yes, indeed, n has a unit norm, because this n hat square minus 1 is 0. So you can consider the quantization of this theory. It is clear that this theory is gauge invariant because this matrix of the Poisson matrix is singular, and I can quantize this theory. One can check explicitly the gauge invariance of the theory under these gauge transformations, and one can write down the components of this conjugate vector gauge current J0 and J1, and one can go to this gauge fixing condition and calculate the Dirac brackets, and then eventually one can calculate the commutation relations, equal time commutation relations, and one has to watch out for the product of these operators appearing here, and therefore the hermeticity has to be maintained by writing down all expressions term by term. Now I eventually come to the nice one, quantization of this theory. So you rewrite this theory on the light front, on the equal light cone time x plus of tau equal to f0 plus x1 equal to constant. You write this theory on that, and here this phi is a new pseudo scalar field. It is constructed out of the topological field n and its space and time derivatives. And you can again check the, you can write down the canonical momenta, you can check the constraints of the theory and canonical Hamiltonian density, total Hamiltonian density, and eventually you can again derive the secondary constraints of the theory. And these constraints, this so set of five constraints, they form a set of first class constraints, and the theory is gauge invariant. One can explicitly check the gauge invariance of the theory, one can construct the components of the conjugate vector gauge current J plus J minus on the light front, and then one can choose these light front gauges. This corresponds to the temporal or time axial gauge in the light front framework, this corresponds to the Coulomb gauge, this also corresponds to the Coulomb gauge for the lambda field, and this is a set of constraints. Under this, you can calculate also the determinant of the matrix of the cross of brackets of the constraints. This is a non-singular matrix now. And you can again calculate the non-vanishing Dirac brackets, and then you can construct the commutation relations. You can write down the first order Lagrangian density of the theory. And eventually, you can also achieve the path integral quantization of the theory. So here, this is the generating functional of the theory, the path integral, which represents the vacuum transition amplitude for the theory, and it is expressed in terms of the total Hamiltonian density of the theory, which I derived earlier. And here, you see this factor d mu. This is the phase space measure of the theory, and here it is written down explicitly. So I declare that the Hamiltonian and path integral quantizations of the theory are now complete. And
could I have 2 more minutes or should I stop?
As you like, I might tell in 2 more minutes.
Yeah.
So beyond this, one could really consider the BRST quantization theory. Theory is gain invariant. I have explicitly written down the local vector based transformations. And the life here is much simpler than my friend John Hiller, who presented his talk with many ghost fields and many more things. The life here is much, much simpler. I have only one ghost field C and one ghost field C bar. So I enlarge the Hilbert space of my theory and I introduce two fermionic ghost fermionic fields C and C bar, which are anti-commuting. And I introduce one non-canisil outgroup bosonic field V, and this delta hat itself is fermionic, so delta hat is square. It's Grassmannian, it's a square vanishing, it's nilpotent. And then, so I can write down the VRST transformations of the theory. I can write down the gauge fixed quantum Lagrangian density of the theory. And I can derive the equations of motion. I can introduce the bosonic momenta and the fermionic momenta with directional derivatives. And I can construct the quantum Hamiltonian density of the theory. And eventually, this is the VRST charge operator of the theory, which is the generator of the VRST transformations. And the theory is also invariant under anti-VRST transformations with the generator FQ bar. And eventually, this Q and Q bar, they are conserved. So their light one-time derivatives are zero and they are nilpotent, so Q square and Q bar square vanish. And here, now this is one crucial point. We follow the philosophy of my friend Marvin Weinstein, who is not here, and his collaborators. So there are some variants of the VRST quantization in the literature. We personally follow this procedure where we impose this dual condition that the Q and Q are both analytical states. And in that case, what happens, the only states that survive are the physical states of the theory, which satisfy the constraints of the theory. And because if you impose only one condition, then there are some more additional states which are not physical. And if you impose both of them, then those things are eliminated. And this is how you achieve the VRST quantization of the theory. And you can project out your original gauge invariant theory, which you really embedded into the larger VRST gauge symmetry. So I think I am through with all the three quantizations of the theory of Hamiltonian, path integral, and VRST of this theory. And one can always go back and try to look that this unit vector n and so on, you see, they have been, so these are the topological fields and the momentum corresponding to that. So a lot of dynamics associated with the topological field n and its canonical momentum by n have been revealed in this particular consideration. For future prospects, here I have taken a very simple case. I have put capital S equal to 0, but you need not do that. The life is a little more complicated, but why not? So one could consider many further generalizations of this theory, and this by no means is a unique choice of decomposition. You can consider many further decompositions within this framework. So the basic principle should be respected, but you can follow different mathematical things. And with that, I would like to stop, and I would like to express my very, very thanks to Barbara and Giovanni for organizing this excellent meeting at this wonderful place of Frascati. And as one usually says, all the roads lead to Rome, then this thing has come out to be true. So we can see, sitting among the audience, people from all parts of the world, and they converge here at Frascati. Thank you all very much.